everybody. It's good to have you here. And we all know why we're here, because we want to learn about the Arts of Interfaith Leadership. And we have a wonderful person who's going to be helping us, and I'll introduce her shortly, Sophia Saeed. But first, I would like to welcome some people that drove a long way to be here, and we really appreciate that, and then tell you a little bit about the sponsors of this, so that you know who's putting this together. First, let's welcome our guest from Clarksville. Dave, would you tell us who's here and introduce yourself as well?
Sure. My name is Dave Daly. I teach religion at University of the Ozarks in Clarksville, Arkansas. And we have several from our college that heard about this and wanted to come. So I can, do you want me to introduce names?
Yes.
Well, here we go. Too late. Starting on this end, it's Jake Sawyer, Nicole Justice, almost said Nicole Kidman. Can you believe that? Caitlin Tolan, and Emily Autry, Badria Murion. Is that close to how to say your last name?
Yeah.
All right. And our university chaplain, Jeremy Wilhelm.
And Doug.
And Doug, right up, sitting apart. Doug Ron. Thank you.
And you may be wondering who is sponsoring this, and if you're not, I want you to wonder that. And one of the groups that's sponsoring this is a group at Hendricks called the Miller Center for Vocation, Ethics, and Learning. And Dr. Robert Williamson right there is the director of that. And I would like for him just to say a word about what that center does and give you a sense of some of its activities, and then I'll tell you about a few more. Please.
It's good to see everybody. The Miller Center is a program at Hendricks that is focused at the intersection of faith, purpose, and service. So we think about, where does our religious life intersect with the ways that we think about what it means to live purposefully in the world in a way that serves something larger than ourselves. So that's what we do kind of in the Miller Center. This year, in particular, the Miller Center, in cooperation with the chaplain's office, our chaplain J.J. Whitney is over here, have been working on building interfaith community on campus. And so we've started a Thursday night program we call Miller Community Meal, where we've had between 70 and 100 students from different religious, spiritual, and philosophical traditions gathering every Thursday night over dinner to talk about and learn to appreciate each other's traditions. So if you are a Hendricks student or even someone around the Conway community and you want to come to those dinners, they're every Thursday night at 5:40, and they last exactly an hour. So you're welcome to come to that. Jay also asked me if I would tell you just a word about a speaker series that we have going on. This is not from the Miller Center. This is from the Religious Studies Department and the Steele Center for whatever the Steele Center is for, Philosophy and Religion, in collaboration with Philander Smith College. This speaker series is called Faith in Black and White, the Church and Race in Colorblind America. It's a four-part speaker series. Two of them are up here at Hendricks. Two of them are down at Philander Smith. And the question is about the role the church has played in both creating racial injustice and also in learning to address issues of racial injustice. We've already had two of our speakers, but there are two more coming up. The first one is Nyasha Jr., who is a womanist biblical scholar at Temple University. She'll be at Philander Smith at 7 o'clock on whatever day that is. That'll be helpful. Tuesday, March the 14th, so coming up in about 3 weeks. And then the last speaker will be here at Hendricks, Dean Emily Towns from Vanderbilt Divinity School. She's kind of the foremother of womanist ethics, and she'll be speaking here on Wednesday, April the 5th at 7 o'clock. This poster will be hanging out over here if you want to get those dates. We'd love to see you at any of those lectures. I'm glad you're here, and enjoy the morning.
Great, thank you. And I think that what he just talked about is so important, because probably we do not sharply separate interfaith from interracial, from multicultural, from interclass. So we're interested in building bridges, not walls, as everywhere we can. So I think that series that you're doing is right in sync with what we're about. A second group that is sponsoring this is newly formed. It's called the Conway Interfaith Network. And this consists of anybody and everybody in this community who is deeply interested in interfaith work. Sophia Saeed has helped organize interfaith networks throughout Arkansas, Little Rock, Fort Smith, Fayetteville. Interestingly enough, Conway didn't have that. It had a ministerial alliance, but it was all Christian. And so we thought we need to have an interfaith network, and she guided us, and we're getting it started. So we are among the sponsors, and if you would like to be a party to a member of the Conway Interfaith Network, Reverend Terry Daly, sitting right there, has been very instrumental. Terry, if you just raise your hand. St. Peter's Episcopal Church. She and I and some others have gotten it started. We're actually leading a little series at a local coffee shop, introducing the world religions at Blue Cell Coffee Shop every Monday night. And we're just like Dr. Williamson, 1 hour and 1 hour alone, 5:30 to 6:30. We were on Islam last week, as a matter of fact, on Native American traditions this week. Yes.
And if you want to be on the email list, please get in touch with me, and I'll make sure that you find out about things going on.
Now, a third sponsor of this is, again, something on the Hendricks campus. It's called the Marshall T. Steele Center for the Study of Religion and Philosophy. And it's been in the business of fostering discussions in religion, religious studies, and in philosophy for about 38 years. And so that the organization sponsors a Friday afternoon discussion here every Friday, 1 hour, 3:30 to 4:30. But that's the third sponsor. So that's who's here. Is there anybody else here that would just like to say, we're here, we're so glad for the Clarksville folks being here. Anybody else here that just wants to say, and I'm kind of representing this group or that group, anybody?
I'm Denise Danielle, representing the Human Rights Campaign, which is located in Little Rock.
Well, thank you so much. Now, on to the business at hand. Anybody that's done interfaith work in Arkansas knows the name Sophia Saeed. And we're very lucky to have her today. She'll be the first to say, I don't know that I do workshops. When I asked her to do this, she said, I don't know that I do workshops. I said, please do it anyway. She's from Pakistan. She moved here with her husband. She has two children, college age. And they first moved to Utah, and she got a Bachelor of Science degree in economics, focusing on women's development from the University of Utah. And then they moved here to Central Arkansas, Little Rock, and she went to the Clinton School of Public Service. And she got a master's from the Clinton School of Public Service in, as I recall, 2011. And at the Clinton School, maybe you know that you need to have a special project. And her project, as far as I understand, was to do women's development work related to Pakistan, in Pakistan. Is that right, Sophia? So she would go from here back to Pakistan and do this research work and come back, and she got her degree. So she has a master's in public service. She's also deeply, deeply interested in interfaith. And I don't know where that comes from, you know, in your heart. Maybe we'll find out. But I know her because every time I want to do something in interfaith, she helps me out. Now, I also teach a course in contemporary Islamic thought. She helps me out there, too. So when I teach that course, my students cannot wait for Sophia Saeed to visit the class, and it's typically the best class of the whole semester. So she is Muslim, and she's also deeply interfaith. She's going to tell you some of the things that she's done. She's a humble person. She doesn't like to brag. That's not very Muslim. But I've asked her to brag, or at least to tell you some of the things, because we want to learn about the things other people are doing so that we can be versed in the arts of interfaith leadership. Sophia, I can't think of anything else that I need to say right now to introduce you, except to say we're so glad you're here. Let's give her a welcome.
You stole my first line. I can't say that I don't do workshops, so. Okay. Do you know how we'll be moving forward?
I'll do it for you.
Oh, there's a remote here. That's okay. You don't have to sit here. I think I can do that. Okay. So the fact is, which Jay already told you, I don't do workshops. So it's going to be a learning experience for you all and for me too, because that is true that we have done, me and many others in Central Arkansas, we have done a lot of interfaith work in the last several years. And I think workshops like these are important to spread word about that work and also to teach others what do we do. So this is the first one. So bear with me, because you're going to learn from me some things and I'm going to learn from you how to do it better next time. Before we so you all know about me, Jay told you, I'm going to talk a little bit about why I got interested into interfaith work. But before we even get there, I think it's really important for me and for you all also to think why you are here. And I don't think this is a very big group that we can't do that. I mean, not everybody has to share it, but if you don't mind, I would like you to just take a few seconds and think what really made you to get up on your Saturday morning and come here. What's your personal motivation to be here? And I don't mind if everybody wants to share, but at least a few. And whoever is ready can just raise their hand. Yes, Terry.
I think mine is a theological reason that comes from my own Christianity, actually. And it's that for me, in Christianity, we say that God became human. And so in that human component of God, in Jesus, we're all connected. And so I think interfaith work recognizes a reality for Christians from a Christian point of view.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely, and that's one of the reasons I was going to share too, and I will. Anybody else? Yes, sir.
I'm a United Methodist part-time local pastor in southern Olono County, which is probably pretty homogenous, and so there's not a lot of interfaith going on there, but I don't know where I'll be next in my next appointment, where I may be in a community that is in need of some interfaith fellowship. Also, as a citizen of this community, I feel ill-equipped to be a part of the interfaith community and to be a part of building that. And so I'm here to figure it out, or at least get started.
Okay, so why interfaith? Yeah, yes.
So I'll just be totally honest. I am working in Little Rock, and I have heard your name so many times. And I have asked the people who say your name to connect me to you, and they say that they're going to do it, but they haven't. And so when I saw that you were the one leading this workshop, I said, I'll just do it myself. And so that's why I'm here.
Okay, thank you for being here. So anybody else on why? And we will connect you again after workshop, again and again. What caused you to be here today?
I have many friends of different faiths, and I feel like it's a really important step for the future of all of our communities, and really for our country, to create communities that not only tolerate or even accept people of different faiths, but also to celebrate people of different faiths. To create stronger communities.
And that's something we hear a lot, actually. I always ask these people this question, and I hear that a lot.
That's just for the connector.
Oh, so I have the wrong?
Oh, I don't think there is a remote for it.
Okay, so I'll tell you some of the reasons which I keep on hearing from people. And for me, it's important because we need to keep on going back and asking why. And why is the most important thing? Because that's what keeps on, that's what makes you keep on going. And some of that would be repetition for those who were here Thursday night. How many of you were in the Miller Center on Thursday night other than Bobby? Okay. So some of that will be repetition. So I'll tell you, I often ask people who reach out to me and say, Sophia, I want to join one of your programs, and ask why. I mean, why do you want to join one of my programs? Why would you want to give your free time to me and not to just go for a hike in the beautiful mountains? So I hear many things, and some of them are here, and some of them I wanted to get from you. And I'll give you my own reasons too. So one of the reasons I started interfaith work was just to protect some of the values, American values, that I have experienced and lived with in this country for 22 years, and protect those values for my children. And I will, I mean, explain it. I came here 22 years ago, and honestly, this was, this is the, and I've traveled to many, many countries in the world. This is one country in the world where really you can go and realize your potential and do what you want to do without having a lot of barriers placed in front of you. We don't realize that as being Americans. We really take this country for granted a lot. We do a lot of criticism and don't see the good things in it. And I have actually had really actualized my American dream in the first 15 years of my living in America. Till 9/11, until we started seeing things being changed for specifically Muslims and minorities. So one of, and I had two children who were in middle school at that time, so one of my reasons to start doing interfaith work was I thought freedom of religion, or freedom of worship and diversity of religion are the two things which make this country very, very beautiful. I think this is the biggest interfaith democracy in the world. And I think we can be more productive in the areas of science and education and health and all those places if we know how to cooperate with each other along the lines of faiths and cultures. And I saw that disappearing for my own children and for my own community. So one of my reasons was a very, very personal reason that I wanted to have my, I wanted my children to experience the same America that I have experienced. So that's why. And then, of course, you all know a lot of prejudice against minorities have been going on for the last few years. We saw what happened to a Jewish cemetery last week. Did most of you hear about it? And then, of course, the mosques and Muslim women. There's lots of harassment and personal incidences of violence against Muslim women. You all know what happens at the airports nowadays. One of the things which really, really affected me was what was happening in Little Rock School District. And what happened in the last couple of years in Little Rock School District is that we had lots and lots of young Muslim children who felt prejudice and discrimination against them just because of the faith that they were practicing. And that affected me a lot because, you know, my kids were in school at that time. And I don't know if you all have read that statistic, but you know, one in every two Americans have a negative view of Islam. One in two, it's a big number, 50%. I think Hendrix cannot correlate with it because it's a very liberal environment that I have seen in the last 2 days. And one in three Americans, like one third of our country, believe that the civil rights of certain fellow Americans should be curtailed only because of the faith that they practice, which is of course Muslims I'm talking about. So one third of your population is thinking that we can change the basic American values of civil liberties, freedom of worship, for Muslims. I mean, this is amazing. This is unbelievable for me. So that's one of the reasons. And of course, many, many people do interfaith work because of the reason that Terry mentioned, my Jewish friends and my Christian friends, because we believe it's a religious duty to do that, to just be good to our neighbor and accept them and treat others the way you want to be treated, the golden rule, and theological reasons too. So one of the things, and of course elections 2016, that has been a big reason. Since the elections, which was November 8th or 12th, we have had calls and emails at Interfaith Center of people who want to get involved in interfaith work, who have never done interfaith work, but they want to get involved now because they want to somehow be a part of this community which is more diverse. And it's obviously a result of the elections, and there are many more reasons, but I do want you to start thinking about your own, many of you did not speak, but your own personal reason. I know we want to be doing interfaith work, but why? What is it deep inside you that calls you to do this work? And reflect on it and meditate about it in order for you to be more productive in the work if you choose to do this work. And I think that's what keeps me going. So why interfaith work? And so what I'm going to do, I think, is that introduce you to different kinds of programs that I have developed and some of the Central Arkansas Interfaith folks have developed in the last few years, and then go into detail of two or three of them, which are very new and current, and then discuss them with you and see how we all can learn from those programs and the skills that I have developed while developing those programs. So what happened, Jay already told you, I was an international development economist. I was working internationally in Pakistan and Philippines and Arkansas and other countries too as a consultant. I live in Arkansas, I just travel as a consultant when I started getting more and more involved in interfaith work. One of my Clinton School project was to start this interfaith youth group that we are going to talk a little bit more about. And that was not a mandatory project. I had an option in my second year to do a Clinton Global Initiative commitment, and we talked about it on Thursday. And that was the time that my kids were in middle school, and I saw a very strong need to do an interfaith initiative that would help them through their middle school experience. So an interfaith youth corps developed out of it. That was my first interfaith program. Once I was done with that youth corps and started working and building, an Episcopal church in Arkansas had a calling to do outreach work. They wanted to create a ministry who can do interfaith work. And the pastor who wanted to do it, her name is Reverend Susan Sims-Smith, she heard about my work and she reached out to me. She said, Sophia, we really want to start doing interfaith work, but we don't know how to. And you're already doing it. Would you please come to our church and would you please build an interfaith center for us? And that was back in 2012. And I said, yes, I mean, this is what I'm doing anyway. So with you all, it will give you more support and structure and logistical help and administrative assistance, so yes, I will do that. So I joined the Episcopal Church as a programs director of the Interfaith Center. And they supported me in whatever I wanted to do, and in the last 6 years, basically, we have created program after program after program. Some of them are just one-time events, like you do a prayer service event. You are really interested in worshiping with others and you want to do an interfaith prayer service. Or you want to do a fellowship meal, like the Miller Center meal that I experienced Thursday night. Or something happens and nationally or locally and you want to respond to that, like we just did an interfaith vigil a couple of weeks ago at the Capitol. So there are one-time events that we do. A prayer service on September 11th. Or on Interfaith Thanksgiving. But a lot of our programming is ongoing programming, like you build a program which keeps on going. For example, the youth group. An interfaith youth group of the high schoolers is a program which meets every other week, and they continue to meet, and they have been meeting for 60 years. So my personal, I started with one-time events, but my personal interest is to do ongoing programming, build those groups of people, and create those spaces which would make it easier for people to come together and interact on a regular basis and form relationships. And we'll talk about both of them. So for example, to give you an example, interfaith youth group, supper clubs. We have interfaith supper clubs in which the same families come together over and over every month and be with each other and spend time with each other. Interfaith book groups, in which you come, read a book together and get to know new people, but the same people meet over and over again. Friendship camp, which Jim and Daniels talked about yesterday. What else? Choirs. So a lot of programming is ongoing programming, and some of the programming is one-time programming. So I'm going to show you a few of those examples, and then we will go into detail and we'll share more experiences. I don't have good, I've been so busy doing creating the interfaith programs, I did not have time to actually make videos or capture what we are trying to do in a good way. So all I have is some clips, which maybe some news media did sometime, or somebody did it for their show. So I'm going to show you those clips, and I hope that from those clips you will get a feel of that program before we get into the depths of those programs. So let's start with the interfaith youth group, which was not a novel idea. It was not even my idea. I've heard about Ibu Patel's interfaith youth course, and I'm sure you all have heard about them, but they're at the college level. And my kids were at high school level, so I wanted to use the same model of interfaith youth corps, but bring it to a high school level from the college level. So let me show you a small clip, which there is a local celebrity, P. Allen Smith. It's a 3-minute clip which he did for one of his programs, but it will give you a feel of the interfaith youth group.
Tristan can help with the system. Yeah.
Okay, let's see. Okay, so this is our youth group, and we will talk more about them in a second. Here they are just walking to a place of worship, going to install a prayer box. Here they are doing a prayer together, a prayer that they all wrote together. This youth group started with 8 kids, high schoolers from Jewish, Christian, and Muslim faiths. But now they have 18. We have capped it at 18, which are Jewish, Christian, Muslim, Buddhist, Baha'i, Hindu, and a seeker, or what you call atheist or agnostic. I don't like those words, so we call them seekers. So they meet twice a month. One time they meet to do a service project together. So like for here, they are at the food bank doing a service project. But once a month they meet to do dialogue together. They sit down and they talk. They talk to each other. And it's a facilitated dialogue. So this will give you a brief introduction, and then we'll talk more about them, hopefully. If it
This shirt has seen 12 seasons of P. Allen Smith Gardens, and it all started right here. But now I think
sorry about that. Okay. I did not know. I need an email to show it to you.
Touch the soil that has shaped so many families. It's a part of our American heritage, and it creates who we are. It's that resilient spirit to overcome the odds.
coming up, we check out a place where kids of all faiths can come together.
There's no right or wrong way of doing it. It's just how you find your peace.
And later, forget canoeing. These kids are learning how to cook at culinary camp. Stay with us. In today's world, it's often a challenge to get young people to unplug from technology and develop real-life interpersonal connections. For the teenagers of a multi-faith group in Arkansas, the House of Prayer in Little Rock provides a space for open discussions as well as meditation.
I'm Emma Figarsky, and I'm of the Jewish faith, and I'm a Muslim. I'm a Methodist Christian.
And I'm a Buddhist.
I'm here today with my youth group, which is called the Malda Faith Youth Group of Arkansas. I started this group 3 years ago, and the reason I started this group was, for me, my faith is very important. I find so much beauty in my faith. But every time you look at the newspaper or media, all you see is faith as a dividing force between people, and that's what I thought they're going through. So I wanted to create this platform of dialogue where youth can come together and have meaningful discussions about their faith, about faith of other students around them.
It's made me think a lot about other religions, not only just what they believe, but also what people stand for.
The whole idea of the group is to have a space which is safe, which is diverse, which is inclusive, where we can not only learn about each other, but we can also respect each other, celebrate each other, and cherish each other's customs and traditions. So we have to be open-minded.
I don't know, I feel like when we learn how different we are, we're like, okay, you're different, I'm different, but we still love the same TV shows, and we still go see the same movies. So we're really just the same, and we can just love each other even though we're like so different.
Most of our dialogue meetings have a specific theme to the meeting. Everything needs to be aligned with their shared values within their own religion. Like today we are meditating, and they all have some form of meditation in their own faith. Once you enter the house of prayer, you enter the pre-meditation room, you take your shoes off, leave all your worldly belongings like your phone and your keys and the noisy stuff outside, and walk into the meditation room. And the room is specifically architecturally designed to help meditate. We are going to have a good 30 to 40 minute dialogue about their experience of meditation. How does it feel like to pray with people of different faiths? I mean, you know, you tell me, when will you ever see a site when you have a room in which there is a Muslim and a Buddhist and a Christian sitting together and praying?
Up next, these kids aren't making macaroni art. They're learning the culinary arts. You won't want to miss it.
Okay, so that's the youth group. Okay. So we'll keep youth group in our mind right now, and we'll go on and discuss some of the skills that we use and need for interfaith work. Any questions about the youth group? Okay. So when Jay asked me to teach about a workshop on interfaith skills, you know what I thought about deep in my heart? I thought, all you need to be is open-minded, willing to accept new perspectives, and step out of your comfort zone. That's all you need to be an interfaith leader. Really, skills come with time. And you develop, I mean, I did not have any skills. You just need to have that willingness in you to step out there and do this work. That's all you need. But since we are talking about skills that I developed and I think would be helpful, so let's talk about that. So first thing I believe, and that's how all of my programming started, the things that I started from scratch, is there has to be a need that touches you deeply. So I call it develop a radar screen. That's what I always tell my kids, that's what I tell myself, that you need to have a radar screen. And you need to think seriously reflect around things that are happening about you, around you, and think what's going on in the religious or interreligious community which affects you deeply, that you want to do something about it, that you can't ignore it. It could be within your family, in your friend circle, in your community, largely at a national scale. Back in 2010, what happened was, and I shared that story Thursday night, we, like many of the families, we sit at our dining table at dinner time and we talk about our days. So one day we were sitting at the dinner table, my daughter was in sixth grade and my son was in eighth grade. And my daughter told us while having dinner that, Mom, you know, Askia, he was called a terrorist by one of the kids in this in his class. And I was like, and that's back in 2010. I'm like, Askia, you didn't talk about it. Why didn't you tell me? And said, oh, Mom, forget about it. Don't mention it. It's okay. I'm like, why is it okay? It's not okay. He said, no, everybody thinks Muslims are terrorists nowadays, so it's okay. Just ignore it. Of course, it disturbed me deeply. And then my daughter said, Mom, don't worry, I took care of it. And I'm like, what? How did you take care of it? Now, that child who tried to harass us, Kya, was a Hindu kid, back at Lisa Academy 6 years ago, and said, Mom, I told him on his face, he told us, Kya, that your God tells you to go and kill others. And I told him that, you know, if my God tells me to go kill others, your God is so cheap, you can go to a store and buy him for $10. And she was so proud of herself. And she has that spark in her. So, I don't remember. Every time I think about this story, I have different feelings. But at that time, I was shocked. I was like, oh my God, one of my child cannot defend himself, cannot stand up for himself and his faith, and the other, look at that bully. She was a bully, she acted like a bully. And the reason it happened was they both did not have the communication tools which were needed to deal with the situation. So that night I thought, I lied in my bed and so there is an optional project at Clinton School called CGI, Clinton Global Initiative. You don't have to do that. But that night I sat down and thought, I am going to submit a proposal in Clinton Global Initiative. I am going to form a youth group for teenagers in which they come together every month with a facilitated instructor who knows how to do conflict resolution, who has communication tools and skills, who can enable our teenagers who are leaders of the future to have better communication skills, to process what's going on globally, process it enough to be able to talk about it, and emerge out of it more empowered, not marginalized. And that's how the youth group was born. So, do you sense that radar screen? And I don't want to talk about each and every project, but literally every project was born like that. Each one of our projects. I'll give one more small example before. I want to listen to you all too. 2 years ago, I have lots of friends who are priests and pastors, Christian. So 2 years ago, among one of our discussions, I heard from one of them very disappointedly that, you know, there is such a huge decline in VBS. It really worries me. And I had no idea what was VBS. And I said, what is VBS? And they said, it's Vacation Bible School. And then I started talking to them more and more about Vacation Bible School. And they explained that, you know, why they think there is a decline in Vacation Bible School and what's happening in the community. And I said, can we have a meeting with some of your other friends who are bothered by the fact that VBS is declining and they want to do something about it? And she said, yes. The name of the pastor is Mary Veno. She's a pastor at St. Margaret's Episcopal Church, and she set up a meeting for me with other folks who are interested in something like a Vacation Bible School, but are not able to do that. So we sat down, we met, and we created a summer camp, which is a twist to Vacation Bible School, called an Interfaith Friendship Camp. But the list goes on and on and on, that, you know, we see something which is happening in the community close to us, touches our heart, and I thought, I need to do something about it, or we need to do something about it. So I think one thing that any leader, let alone an interfaith leader, need to develop in themselves is, you know, to be able to do a needs assessment, to develop that radar screen that what is needed in your immediate community, not globally. We all know elections happen, we all know we need interfaith work, but what's happening around you that affects you, that brought you here in this room? There has to be something. So that's one thing I think is extremely important, and that happens once you start thinking and reflecting and talking to your own self, and then slowly you develop that radar screen. So before we move on to the next level, I want you all to just take a few minutes and think about it. And think about a need in your either family or friend circle or community, a specific need that you have seen, maybe did not even think about it, but you have seen. And look at right and left of you and then share it with the person right next to you. So, I mean, pair up in twos, and then you share it with her and she shares it with you. But think of, and I mean, you don't have to, but there is a lot going on, and if you put your mind to it, you can identify something. And unless you can identify the problem, you can never do something about it. You have to first identify what is it which is wrong around you. So just take a minute to think, a couple of minutes to think about it, and then we'll take 3 minutes to discuss it in a pair, and before we move on. I'm going to go and sit with somebody. So you're three here. Can I join you? I was going to tell you about a survey. It's called IDEALS. It was done by Interfaith Youth Corps. It's a longitudinal survey of college students, over 20,000 college students. It's the largest longitudinal survey of college students about their attitudes, about culture and religion. And one thing, among many, many other things, one thing I read in that survey a while ago was that there's a big chunk of college students, 83%, who believe that if people of different cultures and religion can learn to get along with each other, and I'm going to read it as it is. If people of different religious and non-religious perspectives can learn to cooperate and work together, we can overcome any of the world's major problems. 83% of the college students believe that. And then when you go back and ask them that, you know, how many of you are working with people of different faiths, or how many of you have attended a faith work or a worship service, or a simple question, how many of you have participated in interfaith dialogue? Only 19%. So then 83% of us believe that this is extremely important to save the world, if I may say, that's what they say. Only 19% are engaged in doing something about it, so there is a big gap. There's a disparity, like we have a desire, but we are not able to do something about it. So anyways, I think it's really, really important that we are here, because we need to bridge that gap. Most of us do believe that interfaith work is important. Interfaith cooperation is the way to go for the next century. But what are we doing about it? Most of us do not know what to do about it. So that's why the first question, that look around in your community, and identify something that needs to be done. And then do not wait for others to take a step. There are no others. It's just you. When I had to do this project, honestly, I thought, I mean, I know nothing about interfaith work. And look at me, I'll go out and start talking to people. They won't even trust me because I look different and I dress different. Right when we started this youth group, I mean, I thought about the idea, now how to do it. I mean, you all can think about ideas right now how to do it. The first step on most of the programming if you want to work with the community. So there could be educational programming like this. You invite a speaker and they can talk about Islam or Buddhism or Jainism, and that's wonderful. That's educational programming. You're educating people of different faiths, and we need to. There is a need for that. But if you are teaching people to cooperate with each other, then you're going to create collaborative programs in which people are coming together over and over again and working with each other. That requires bringing those people together. That requires community outreach, which is, in my opinion, the most challenging and hardest part of interfaith work. How to reach out to folks, how to gain their trust for them to come and work with you. So my first project was the youth group back in 2010. And I really did not know how to start. So for those of you who do not know how to start, I'm here to help you. It's easy. But at that time, I had no idea. I was new in Little Rock. So I started researching and Googling, are there any interfaith organizations? And I discovered there's an organization called the Arkansas Interfaith Alliance, run by a Methodist pastor, Reverend Steve Copley. That was the only thing I found. I did not know, I had no church connections, nothing. So I found his email, I wrote to him, I said, this is what I really want to do. I applied to Clinton Global Initiative to form a group like that. My grant got my proposal got accepted. I got a grant to go to the university and get training in conflict resolution. I'm all ready to go, but I have no connections in this city. Would you please help me? Because our missions are so similar based on what I read on your website. And he responded back to me. He said, yes, Sophia. And I said, let's meet. So we sat down. We met. I was brand new in Little Rock. And then he helped me to connect to different churches in town. Methodist, Episcopal, even Temple, and Baptist. And it took me good 6 to 8 months to go through that recruitment process, after which I recruited only 8 high schoolers. It really was not easy. So basically, if he connected me with Jay Clark, one of the priests at Pulaski Heights, or Anthony Pulaski at First United Methodist, I wrote to them, I took appointments, I went, I sat down, I met with them, I gave them my vision, I said, can I please meet with your youth pastor? I met with the youth pastor, I met with the youth groups, gave them our vision, tried to sell them the idea, but it took me sick, and sometimes met with the parents, because some of the kids were interested, but parents were not. They were like, why do you want to be a part of this youth group? Maybe, will there be any preaching? What will you do? Who will monitor what you're talking about? Who will facilitate? What will be the curriculum? Question after question after question. And I was actually developing curriculum at that time too, but what I'm trying to say is it is a process if you do not have relationships. And I'll keep on coming back to this word, relationships. Relationships. So it took me 6 to 8 months to be able to recruit 8 kids with the help of Interfaith Arkansas and trips after trips after trips to church. One Jewish kid, 4 Christians, and 3 Muslims. Even Muslim children were not interested. The ones who knew me very well, they were not interested. Why do our kids need to be sitting with Christian kids and learning about God knows what? Because one of the things which I'm very intentional about in my interfaith programming is that we do talk about faith. Faith is the basis of all the interfaith programming that we do. Whatever faith you belong, or spirituality, if I may say. So the moment you start talking about spirituality and faith, and especially with teenagers and young kids, there is a fear right there. The fear of, you know, why, how, what will be the outcomes, what will be the results. So once, number one, you have to work through that fear. And it's really strong. What helps is building trust with people. And how do you build trust? By creating relationships. So now 6 years later, I had this really deep desire to start an interfaith youth board. It literally, and I'm not exaggerating, took me 2 phone calls. I called the music director, whom I know personally, that she is interested in interfaith work. And I asked her if she would need a youth choir for me. And I will recruit and I will make the curriculum and pick up the music and the songs. But would she teach? She said yes. I called another church and asked the head pastor, I need a room. I need a choir room. I need this, this, this. He said yes. I wrote out to all my congregation. And when I say my congregation, we have been able to build an interfaith congregation in the last 6 years. So I sent an email out, we're developing an interfaith choir, are you interested? And I had 20 kids within 2 days. So do you see the difference 6 years ago and now? Huge difference. Why? I was able to build relationships and not people trust. So why do we need to do that? This is a very, and relationships, there are three things which are key, and we'll keep on coming back to them again and again, but we're just talking about relationships. Why? Because there is a fear out there, and you all know that. You all know that. There is a fear of the other. And why is there a fear? There are so many incidences of harassment, violence lately. Is there a fear because we are inherently violent? Or people really hate Muslims? No. The fear is because mostly people are ignorant about the other faiths. And there are two things we need to do to counter that ignorance. One is education, which, like what you are doing at the coffee shop, you educate people about different faiths. And education is really, really, really important. I mean, we have no idea how illiterate we are about other faiths, including myself. And I've been I spend more time with Christians and Jews than with Muslims. But I'm still so far behind in my education. So of course education. But the key is relationship. Education will only take you so far. And this is for all of you out there who are interested in interfaith work. The key, the next step, the most important thing, the key is relationship building. Being able to connect others at a human level. Like knowing Sophia as Sophia, a woman who has desires and aspirations and goals and loves and fears and all of that. Not knowing her as a Muslim woman necessarily. And once you have connected at the basic human level, then it's much, much easier to do interfaith work. So in the beginning it was hard, but now it starts with building relationships. And I really believe that if you want to start interfaith work, start with a relationship, with a pre-existing relationship. So that brings me to the next point, recognize gifts. So all of you have gifts. We all have gifts. Assets. In our public servant term, we call it asset mapping. We all have gifts that we can use to put towards this work. We need to identify those gifts, number one. And I think if any gift I have, which has made my work easier, and I've been able to move much, much faster in developing this organization than others, I think, and I might be wrong, that I'm able to identify people's gifts and connect them to the right need. So let me give you a few examples before we go on. So when Susan Sims-Smith contacted me to join the Interfaith Center and develop the organization and bring the mission forward, we started talking. I just did not go and do a program. We just started talking. And we started meeting and formed a friendship, which is one thing that I cherish very, very deeply. We formed a friendship which was very important to her and to me because we found some connections. You know, we both listen to our dreams, we both meditate, we both are very reflective in some ways on some experiences. So we formed a deep, deep friendship. So I just shared another need identification process with these with this group, which I'll share with you quickly. So a few years ago, we hosted a lunch for the faith leaders of Arkansas. We invited everybody to come and have lunch with us, me and Susan. And we had 25 or 27 people who came and did lunch with us. And among one of the questions that we posed to them on the agenda during lunch is that, what is the need that you see around you? The question that I posed to all of you. And one of the men who was sitting there, he was from Palestine, and he said that it was right after when Boston bombing happened in Boston, and two Russian youth did those attacks on a train subway station, and he said, I have five children in Central High and Lisa Academy. And the day after the Boston bombing, they went to school, and each one of them came back with a negative or fearful experience of how they were treated at school because people connected my kids with the terrorists in Boston. They have no idea what my faith is about. They don't know who we are. What is Islam about? We just needed a scapegoat, and my kids became the target. So that's what the man said, and of course, it touched us deeply and many others, among other needs. So me and Susan sat and thought about it, thought about the gifts we have. So one of the gifts, I actually made a list that, you know, what are the assets we have. So one of the gifts that we identified was me and Susan share a very special relationship between a very devout Muslim who takes pride in her identity, who does not want to hide her Muslim identity, and a very devout Christian who's a pastor, who's a priest, and who's really devoted to Jesus Christ and her life as a Christian, living in the presence of Christ. And we have a very special friendship. We seek out each other's help on issues and all of that. So we thought that our friendship is a gift, among many other things. So once we identified a few needs, we identified our gifts, we thought we were going to use this gift to build an educational program. That program was built 4 years ago. It's called Christian-Muslim Dialogue. And basically, it's a six-week dialogue series. And it's quite powerful. Like Jay said, I don't like to brag, but it's really powerful. So both of us, we go to different churches or mosques or temples, and we stand in front of the audience once a week for 6 weeks in a row, and we educate them on a topic from Christian and Muslim perspective. So a six-week series would look like this, that we'll go for 6 weeks and we'll talk about, 1 week we'll talk about Jesus Christ, another week we'll talk about prayer, or violence and extremism, or women, or dreams, or meditation, or food. But Susan will talk about it from a Christian perspective and me from a Muslim perspective, but we'll use our relationship, because we spend a lot of time together, as an example to help people see the differences between both the faiths and commonalities between both the faiths. Because we thought it's a gift and we can use it towards spreading education, and we did. So you see what I'm saying when I talk about recognized gifts? Now I have so many people in my circle that it's, tons and tons of people that when I want to build a program, I just sit down and think about them. Like I wanted to build a choir, so I started thinking about my friends. This person is interested in music. This person knows how to teach. This person can write music. I invited all of them to sit with me and have a meeting because they already have those gifts. And I asked them, you know, you can put your gifts to good God's use if you help me develop this interfaith choir. So, need identification is extremely important, but also the gifts recognition within yourself and in others. Everybody has a gift. Some people speak well, amazingly well. Some people play music. I have a person, I know somebody who's an amazing cook. She did an interfaith culinary workshop for us. I know a Palestinian man which has visited St. Peter's Episcopal too, who's a great storyteller, I think. He's from Palestine. So when we do one of our programs, which is called a listening session, I always take him and his daughter as one of my panelists because he's a great storyteller. With people who are really interested in sports, and they helped us put the first ever interfaith sports event in Curran Parkway, in Curran Park, in Southern Little Rock. So if you really want to be a leader out there, you have to look at the people with their gifts, identify those gifts, and connect them with the need in the community to help initiate or start a program. So I want to go to Friendship Camp because that will give you one of our programs that will give you example of, you know, identifying some of the needs in the community and recognizing the gifts in the community and connecting them, because if you make those connections, you create synergies and you develop such relationships that, I mean, they'll amaze you. So I'm going to show you a video which is much longer, but I hope you enjoy it. So this is the brief story of Friendship Camp. I told you about VBS story, that some of my Christian friends were really worried that they can't do VBS anymore because their congregation is not interested anymore. So we had a group which came together in 2015 and sat down and talked about it. How about if we do a summer camp on the model of VBS, but instead of having Christian kids doing Bible study, we'll have Christian, Jewish, Muslim kids doing Bible, Quran, and Torah study within their own group. So Christians will learn about Christ, and Muslims will learn about Muhammad and all of that. And then they will also come together and do activities which will help them learn about the faith of other kids and help them accept them as persons of faith, kids of faith, and then learn how to get along, play together, not to get into those stereotypes, because we have had issues in Little Rock school district at elementary school levels when kids were harassing each other. So this thing is starting very, very early. And then how some basic team building things, but putting faith back in the picture. Most of the time when we do these interfaith stuff, we take faith out, because we don't know, we are scared of talking about faith. My son, he's not a very devout Muslim, but he's a practicing Muslim. His best friend is Jewish. And I asked him 2 years ago, something happened, and I said, did you and Jacob talk about it? I don't know, some global terrorist. I said, no, Mom, we never talk about faith. I'm like, you live with Jacob. You both live together, you don't talk about faith? Said, no, it's how we just don't, it's hard. I mean, he just didn't know what to say. And then I helped him understand that if your faith is a big part of your personality, and Jacob is a Jew, a practicing Jew, you guys need to open up about your faith discussions. See how it's going to empower you. It was really, really hard for my son. But slowly, with time, because he was in the youth group too at that time, he learned how to talk about his faith. And then they did start talking. So that conversation is extremely important. You will see a Jewish girl in this video. Third grade Jewish girl. She came to this camp, Friendship Camp. So we had 33 kids. We started with 33 kids. Last summer was our first summer. It was a week-long camp, 9 to 5, full day of activities. The Jewish girl, I met her, I did not teach anything. I just built relationships with kids. So first day she was really scared, and she did not want to talk about the faith. On fifth day, the last day, I talked to her and I said, how do you feel today? And she said, Sophia, the first day somebody asked me in the hallway, what faith do you belong to? And I did not want to say I'm a Jew. I did not know what to say. But today I can tell people I'm a Jew. Just 5 days, the child was able to just claim her identity and be proud of who she is when she was with people of other faith. And that strength and confidence did not come to her from being in a temple. It came to her from being with kids of different faiths and talking about faith, because that's what they did in the whole week. And no preaching at all, because our goal is that every person who comes to our programming, they need to go back strengthened and deepened within their own faith. Because if I personally believe, and somebody asked me a long time ago, a Christian who did not trust me, and I was new in that, wouldn't you want all Christians to become Muslims? I said, no, I want all Muslims to become real Muslims. I want Christians to become Christ-like and Muslims to become Muslims. And that's one of our goals, that we need to strengthen our own spirituality, and it really helps us accept others. So I think I've been talking for too long. So I'm going to show this video.
Do we need a break? Who needs a break? You want to go straight to the video, or do you want a break before the video?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, thanks.
Okay. So it will introduce you to the big team. It's a team of 25 people which came from 8 different congregations. So 8 congregations, like you have St. Peter. So 8 congregations got together to put this camp together. And we met for a year designing curriculum, planning activities, logistics, food, hiring teachers. I mean, just tons and tons and tons of stuff. And one thing I want to say before I play it, which is extremely important, or no, after I say, after I play. Okay. I saw this video first time last night because this was not ready. And I pushed the person who was making it to send it to me today so I can show it to you all. And when I saw it last night, honestly, it made me cry because I have so many memories with this experience.
For some people, they think of this as a week of summer camp, and we're so thrilled to think of it as the first week of a better world.
We want to help bring more peace into our world by creating relationships, good, healthy relationships among people who are different from one another, which was an effort, is an effort, to reduce the hatred and fear among the world's religions.
Sometimes I do feel like I'm left out because I'm basically the only Jewish girl in my class.
We did not know what would be the outcomes of this project. All we knew was we have done a lot of interfaith work for teenagers and adults. We have done educational programming, we have done relationship building, we have done interfaith prayer service, but we never worked with elementary age school kids.
I think it's important for our kids not only to know what we believe, but to be able to know something about what the other faiths believe and what is different about it so they can have that conversation.
I believe that this is the generation who can change the world.
My wife, Jennifer Reimer, is on the board of Interfaith Arkansas, representing the Baha'i faith. So we have very strong interest in collaborating with our co-religionists.
I was invited to become involved in the project because I'm a Jewish educator. I said in the meeting, I thought this is something that I've never really considered, and the idea of getting involved in interfaith work was something that was time for me to do that.
We decided to create this camp for third through fifth graders to give them an opportunity to have fun together, to learn about each other's faith in a safe environment, and create relationships, friendships. So that's why we called it the Friendship Camp.
Okay, on your mark. Get set. Let's go!
We built a team of almost 20, 25 volunteers who are coming from 8 different organizations to put together the first ever interfaith friendship camp of not only Central Arkansas, but of Arkansas and in America as well.
When we heard the idea, I mean, I think my exact first words was, we're all in.
I'm very happy to learn that people want to do something about it. So when ideas like this come their way, instead of analyzing them at a very, you know, academic level, is that how it's going to help out my kids, they just jump on it because that's the best they can do to help the situation that the world is in. It's not about making people believe the same thing, but about how each of us have something to offer to help individuals grow in their own faith and their own spirituality.
I think learning about religion is fun because you get to know more about your religion and other people's religion.
Thank you.
So we decided to divide into smaller groups, and one of those groups was curriculum development. It wasn't just what we were going to teach, but it was also, what do we do with the carpool line, and how do we involve the volunteers? So we have not only the religious part that we worked on, but also cooking and art and music and all the other components that make up a camper's day. It occurred to me that maybe we should do something that everyone can buy into, which would be superheroes. The rest actually flowed from that, because we had superheroes, then everyone can be a hero, and let's figure out what components of each religion are universal and allow us to see what we all have in common as opposed to what we have, what are the differences are.
It calls on memories of the lives of the founders of all of these faiths, as well as more recent heroes. And it gives examples to children of how they can develop the qualities of a hero and take the kinds of actions that a superhero would do.
I like superheroes a lot because I watch a lot of superhero movies, and that they are good and they fight evil.
And I love the idea that you can see my get up. Okay, I'm super looped, but really what I say is we're all super friends. You know, and I remember that show as a kid, that they all had different superpowers, but they were super friends, and when they united, they could do a whole lot.
You don't have to be someone who has powers and stuff like that to be a hero. You can just be a normal person just trying to help your friend from a bully or something.
My favorite game was probably Ships and Sailors, like a pirate game. When I went to science, I loved the experiments that we did, and we made slime.
It's been an amazing experience. We've learned about all the different faiths, Baha'i, Christianity, Judaism, and Islam. And I've worked together and made really good friends.
I don't think there is a least favorite. There's no least favorite. I love this week of camp, and I wish that I could be here longer.
I remember the kids here because they're very nice.
My very favorite part is meeting all these new friends, because I don't have that much friends, so I'm glad I made some more friends. My favorite part, I think, is the superhero exercise.
Come to this camp. It's been really nice to see the kids just be kids and play.
Our hope is that this is just the beginning of what will become a long-standing tradition and a growing tradition here in our city.
My expectations are that they will deepen their own faith and the understanding of who they are in their faith and what their faith means.
It's been a joy to work with people of other faiths, and also the perspective they have taught me of it's not all about the schedule. It's not all about the details of the program, but about the relationships and the things that happen in camps like this. And we're going to try to work on planning some service projects or some things that aren't particularly related to a specific faith that would just get them together again.
Now you're going to make me cry. These kids have given up and given me warm hugs. Everybody's calling me Grandpa Dan. It doesn't matter whether they're Jewish, Christian, Muslim, or Baha'i. I think I have not felt so loved since the last time I was with my own grandchildren.
What comes in right now is I start thinking about the Beatitudes. Blessed are those who are peacemakers. I don't think the kids have any thought that they're being peacemakers.
Working with the children, I really see how easy religious peacemaking can be.
This certainly has me thinking about my own spiritual life, and about practices that I can cultivate to just be more intentional in the way that I live.
The idea of acceptance and love and kindness and the golden rule was really preached here, and I believe that they'll leave here with more of an understanding of other things that they might not talk about.
We don't need to be in our quarantine environment. We need to be out and let the kids know that we all are sane and we all are one.
I would invite any person
person of faith to take a deep and wonderful and holy breath and remember that our faith is very internal, even if we speak different faith languages and wear different faith clothing and do different faith holy days. It's all an expression of that beautiful breath.
I believe this work is so important, and I believe that we can create a more peaceful world, decreasing the fear. So we need to be brave, and we need to take these opportunities and teach parents and children alike that we can be in relationship with one another, and it can be peaceful and joyful.
Okay, we'll take a break now and then we'll come back and use this as a learning tool for the next half an hour. Okay, so back to the friendship camp. We'll see some, you all saw the video, which just got to me last night. And all the things that I talked about earlier, you know, being the radar screen, identifying needs, doing the community outreach, identifying gifts, connecting them to the right need, putting people to the best use. So they are fulfilling their calling too, and they are actually producing something that they, doing something that they love to do, and then making this world a better place. All of those components or skills that we talked about were used in the friendship camp, and we can talk a little bit more detail about them, but let's just see some pictures first. So part of the camp was spent, as you can tell from the video, learning about each of the four faiths that we had the kids from, Jewish, Christian, Muslim, and Baha'i. And the rest of the time was spent just doing fun activities and helping kids bond with each other over those activities. So they had a lot of team building activities. And on the right side on the picture, you see they're doing team building activities. And we had St. Mark's Episcopal Church took a lead on those team building activities. And they developed a curriculum for that and worked hard on, our superhero Luke worked hard on doing those. They did a lot of educational programming, which is right there, learning about, we have Ellen, who was the educational director at Temple, and Jeannie, who was educational young pastor at Second Presbyterian, and of course, the principal of the Islamic school. All three of them worked together to come up with an interfaith religious curriculum that most of the faith groups would be fine with, and I sent that curriculum to different pastors and imams and rabbis, three rabbis, so they can approve that these kids are okay to learn about other faiths at this level, and their parents will be okay. So we had a lot of faith-based teaching which went on there. We had arts and crafts, we had meditation, we had cooking, because I thought kids would love to cook. It's a good team building activity. We had music, we had dance, we had art, because all those activities helped people, kids come together. And basically the, let's go to the next slide. And yes, we had prayers. On the upper right corner, you see the Muslims pray, but we also had time for Christians to pray and Jews to pray, all of them at prayer time. Normally, they were mixed up in their classes. We had three classes, and each class had 11 students, a total of 33, and they were divided up in Christian, Muslim, Jews. But at one point in time, for 40 minutes during the day, they would divide up and go to their own faith groups and just do meditation and prayer with the kids of their own faith, because we believe it was really important not to only talk about faith, but also give them an opportunity to practice. And of course, music and their superhero theme. So going back, the way it started was we identified a need. Then I went to, it didn't take long, like a month, to 8 different congregations and met with groups of people, like, you know, the pastor, young pastor, youth pastor, administrator, talk to them about this idea and see how they can help us, if they want to help us, and if they want to be a part of that team, which we call Friendship Camp Team. Actually, I met 12 churches, and finally, we got a yes, or we got a very positive response from 8 congregations, which was 1 Jewish, 1 Muslim, 1 non-denominational, and the rest of them were all Christian churches, Methodist, Presbyterian, and Episcopalians, yes. And then once we put the team together, it was a team of over 25, it went up and down. I went through exactly the same process. We started looking at what are the needs of the camp now, internally the needs. We need a cooking class, we need a meditation class, we need a logistics person, we need a carpool person, we need Jewish teacher, Christian teacher, Muslim teacher, team building teacher, music teacher. And then we started looking at people's gifts. And lots of those gifts were found within that group of 25 volunteers, and some of that we didn't find there. So I had to go outside the group and start recruiting, you know, just to my friends that you are a great cook, would you like to just come and teach one class a day with this group of kids? So exactly the same process, need identification, community outreach, building trust. I even showed people curriculum that this is what we are going to teach before they said yes to me. And trust me, it was hardest to get the buy-in from Muslims and Catholics, the hardest. Took me the longest time. And Muslims means my own mosque, my own Islamic school, because the questions were, why do they need to learn about Jesus? We already know about Jesus, we love Jesus, we have our own way of looking at Jesus. Why do they need to learn about, why do our kids at this young age be exposed to Judaism or Baha'i faith? And Catholics were a total door shut. I couldn't, we just couldn't get our foot in there. Muslims, I had to do some arm twisting initially, but finally, since lots of my congregation really trusts me, they send their kids, not because they were interested in sending their kids to this camp, they send their kids because they trusted me. So see how important relationship building is? Because if it was somebody else, I mean, they did not believe in the vision of the camp, but now they do. And now they're really eager to send their kids next year. So anyways, then, you know, asset mapping, gift identification, connecting them together, and then just start building. So the team met for 1 year, every month. For the first 8 months, they met once a month, every year, a large team. And the next 4 months, they met twice a month and sometimes every week to put this together, because we did not have any financial resources. We just had these groups who wanted to do that. So that was the process, and we'll just discuss it in a minute, but I want to highlight two things which are very, very important to me. Number one, you can create any interfaith initiative that, just build it out of scratch, out of your imagination. There is no right or wrong way of doing it. There is not a set rule that you can only do these. You can do whatever you want. I mean, create an interfaith cooking class, an interfaith or tracking or sports, or whatever. But if the process of creating that program, whatever program you're creating, the process in itself is an interfaith process, your program will be much more effective, sustainable, and impactful. And by process, I meant my team. So I did not go out to a group, my friends, and said, we're going to do it together. Let's apply for grants. Let's put it together. No, no, no. Or St. Margaret's Episcopal Church, which hires me and who could have given me all the resources to do that. No. But the process that I picked was a harder process, and I hope, Terry, you remember when we met the first time to do this widening the circle or interfaith consortium, I talked about this process, that reach out to different groups, different faith groups, bring them together, and ask them, I mean, get their buy-in, and let them create this initiative. Whatever baby you are creating, let the interfaith group create that baby. So creation of the interfaith program, that process needs to be an interfaith process. You need to have people from different faiths sitting around the same table and discussing and talking and debating at times and coming to consensus. And that team, all those people that you saw in the video, they're local people. I'm sure you know most of them. from Little Rock. That team, they have to meet together every month now. They miss each other so much because they built such a strong relationship working with each other, developing the camp. So people, outsiders think when they say, oh, you guys did amazing, the friendship camp, they think friendship camp is an interfaith project. Actually, creating the camp is a bigger interfaith collaboration. And those relationships which were formed between those 20 to 30 people, long lasting, never ever going to go away. So that's one thing I wanted to mention. And then you learn a lot. Like one day my curriculum team was sitting and making a plan of how kids will, you know, talk about, learn about the prophets from Jewish, Christian, Muslim traditions, and the activity will be that, you know, we will give them color sheets and then color the pictures of the prophets. I'm like, no, Muslim kids cannot deal with the pictures of the prophets. I mean, pictures of prophets is a no-no in Islam. So we cannot do that activity. So Christians and Muslims, I mean, that was a learning moment. You know, oh, okay. So you can't draw pictures? No. Okay, we won't do Muhammad, but we can do Jesus and Moses, peace be upon them all. So no, no Muhammad, no Jesus, no Moses. Muslim kids cannot draw prophets at all. It's just a way we respect prophets. Anyways, so I just give that small, and then many other things. Cooking class, I mean, it took us a long time to create meals which were vegetarian and halal and kosher and all of that. So the process was really enjoyable, blissful. I think about that process and I miss it more than the camp action itself. So that's one thing. Think about the process more than you think about the outcome. And outcome will be beautiful if your process is interfaith and collaborative. And everybody has a strong buy-in over it. And you have different people bringing in different perspectives sitting at the table. And the second thing which I quickly want to mention is I just met Lieta. Lieta, right? Mm-hmm. Where are you, Lieta? Okay, so she came to me and she introduced herself and she said, I would like to help because I always wanted to do a summer camp and this was my dream and you exactly did what I wanted to do. So Lieta is going to work with us in this summer, but I want to highlight that Hendrick students and alums have been a big support for Interfaith Center. The video that you saw, all of the kids' shots, most of it was shot by a Hendrick student. Her name is Taylor Lomas. She came to me through Jay McDaniel, and she spent 45 hours in that week in the camp with the kids, shooting every moment of what they're doing, absolutely free. It was not a paid job. None of these people had paid jobs. She had a gift, and gift was she loved making movies, and she wanted to be with people of different faiths. I gave her that opportunity. I am blessed to have her take that offer that would you please come and be with the kids and shoot them. She took it. My youth group that we talked about, I have three counselors for the youth group who are trained for the youth discussions. Two of them are from Hendricks, Blake Tierney and Sarah Hinman. They're Hendricks students. One project that I did was I've been wanting to create an interfaith hospitality manual for a long, long time. And once Jay McDaniel asked me that some kids were needing to do a project and you asked me if we have a need. And I said, yes, we need an interfaith hospitality manual. And three of Jay's students worked with us for 4 months and they created a manual which we have used over and over again. And I want all of you to go back to it if you want to do an interfaith initiative and look at it. It's an amazing document. It will tell you everything from entering to greeting to eating to, I mean, anything that you need to know for interfaith fellowship. That was created by Hendrick students. So I wanted to highlight that too. To tell you that, you know, I hope we'll have more students coming from Hendrick's again. So,
University of
the Yes. Oh, yes, absolutely. So, do we want to talk about the friendship camp or any questions that you all have? Yes, sir.
Was there follow-up with the campers after the summer event that you had that they met throughout the year or whatever to reconnect and sort of work on that?
So, yes. Absolutely. So camp was such a beautiful experience that these kids wanted and the families wanted to come back together. Mm-hmm. So the camp happened in July. So we met in August for a picnic. Uh-huh. And then out of the camp, did you see a small musical piece in the camp where kids were singing Shalom, Salam? They loved the music so much. And especially I was really proud of Muslim families because a lot of Muslims do not play music. They loved the music part so much that one of the feedback I got was our kids loved singing peace songs. And all those songs were like kind of not, I shouldn't say non-denominational. They were coming from different faith traditions but focused on peace. So we have another program which is born out of this camp. Let's move forward. Yeah, let's stay here. Which is called Interfaith Children's Choir. It just started on Martin Luther King Day. We inaugurated it on this January 17th. And these are all the camp kids. Not all of them, but some of the, there are 20 kids in the choir. This is the first interfaith choir that I know of in our state. They're all elementary school kids. They all came from the friendship camp. They meet once a week, every Tuesday from 4 to 5. And I have a curriculum from them, songs which are coming from Jewish, Muslim, Christian, and Hindu traditions that they are learning to sing. Very universal songs, peace songs. Here's their teacher who's a music director at Second Presbyterian Church. And I talked about it briefly, like, you know, how we put it together. There was a need. And the need, not a need like something is wrong in the community, but a desire. Because these kids sang in the camp, then they sang at one of the interfaith prayer service that we did. I mean, they kept on coming back and singing again and again. So I saw the desire. So I called them, would you like to have an interfaith youth choir? Mm-hmm. I found two people, a coordinator and a director who would be willing to lead them. They meet every week nowadays. And these are the camp kids and camp families. And then this summer, we'll do the next camp. Hopefully, the camp will happen every year. We'll just change the location. First year, we were at an Episcopal church, St. Margaret's. This year, we're doing it at Second Presbyterian Church. Next year, I'm hoping we'll go to Islamic Center or the temple. But the team will remain the same who will plan the camp. And some of these kids who have not outgrown elementary school, they will come back. And others are bringing their friends and their cousins and the kids that they know, because they had a, remember in the video we asked all the kids what was your least favorite, and nobody had any least favorite. They all loved the camp. So I don't have any choirs video, but I have a clip that Channel 11 did on us. It's a 2-minute thing. I can show that to you in a minute to tell you more about the choir. But it was a, so the choir is a 6-week program. And it finished this Tuesday, and tomorrow they're doing a closing concert. If anybody in Little Rock is interested, we have a concert tomorrow at Second Presbyterian Church, 3 to 4 p.m., where these kids will do a 30-minute concert. So, back to friendship, and this was born out of those families who just refuse not to meet, actually. So, any other questions? Yes, Jeff.
Yeah, so it is Jews, Muslims, Christians, and Baha'i.
Yes.
It, next year will it be, I like the focus, in other words, I think, I understand that gives it focus. And then there are other peoples not represented in those just named. Is your desire to expand it or to keep that focus?
Well, initially the desire was to keep it at Abrahamic faiths level, because I thought we won't be able to handle more. It all depends on the team. But then we found two Baha'i educators, Dan and Jennifer Reimer. I think they're from Conway or North Little Rock. So we started Baha'i. This year, Hindu community is joining us. We still won't have Buddhist, or because I don't want to introduce a new faith if I do not have good educators who can help us create and evaluate the curriculum that we are going to make. So the desire is to expand. I know we cannot be too big because it's only a 1-week long camp. But this year we'll have 5 days. Yes.
And just related to that, at some point before we close, if you were talking about the teenage groups you've worked with and the role of agnostic, spiritual but not religious, you know, the people that are not affiliated, how they fit in to interfaith work. Not at this level, but at other level.
Actually, at this level too, we had a child in our group who was, because we asked questions to them all the time. So one of the key things that there are three things which I'm going to re-emphasize, if you can go back to, just keep on going back. Okay, yeah. Forward, we did that. No. Let's go forward.
Yeah.
We did, back. go slow. Okay, go back. Okay, we did that. Go forward. Here. So we did some of the skills, right? Which I, again, re-emphasize through these programs. There are, I don't want to call them skills. I want to call them some, they are skills, but for me, as an interfaith leader, these are, this has become a lifestyle. They are skills, but they need to become your lifestyle if they want to do interfaith work. Listening, relationship building, and unlearning. We'll talk about all three of them. And of course, we'll talk about, Jay, your question. So listening is a key thing. You want to be an interfaith leader or a person, you need to start listening. Listening to the folks around you, listening to your own self, in my opinion. I mean, I am no authority. This is my first workshop. I'm just telling you everything that is coming from my experience. I have not learned it. But honestly, listening to the divine presence as well. So listening to others, listening to your own self, which requires a lot of reflective, meditative time, and listening to divine presence. So all of our programs have a lot of listening in that. Like in summer camp, we asked children's question all the time. What is your faith? You're a Muslim, why are you Muslim? What do you love most about Islam? So we had a child in our summer camp who was Pastafarian. And I had no idea what is a Pastafarian. Mm-hmm. Do you all know what is a Pastafarian? Does anybody know?
Rastafarian?
Pastafarian.
Spaghetti Modified Spaghetti.
Church Defined Spaghetti.
Yes, spaghetti. I had no idea. I was actually shocked to see something like that. So we are not only dealing with faith groups or atheists or agnostics or seekers, also Pastafarians. And that child was a Muslim child, Turkish, who chose to be a Pastafarian. So can anybody explain in a line what is Pastafarian? What is it? This is not a faith, it's an ideology, right? Or a satire on faith? I still don't get it completely.
We need somebody to speak for it here.
I mean, I've said what I know. I understand it as a satire on, satirical comment on being religious, but there may be people who hold it very sincerely, but it's the figure of the religion as a flying spaghetti monster.
It's kind of like based on an essay or a book that I think Hitchinson wrote.
You know more than I do at this point.
I think Christopher Hitchens kind of wrote it, and it was kind of praised that he had more faith in a 400-pound spaghetti monster.
So it's, based on what I understood, it's a mockery on the institution of religion, if I'm right. And the first day when that child talked about being a Pastafarian, and then he kept on bringing that belief system in, and that's why the process is important. It was a huge debate between, in my curriculum team, do we want a Pastafarian in the camp? Because we are very, everybody who's working with Interfaith Center, there is some grounding in spiritual presence, if not with organized religion. Or you have to be at least a seeker. But Pastafarian is purely a mockery on faith and spirituality. But we decided, no, we cannot say no. And maybe if he does not learn from us, we will learn something from him. And he needs to stay in the group. And he did stay in the group. And he loved the friendship camp. And he's coming next year. And similarly true for the teenagers too. I don't meet with them anymore regularly. My coordinators do, the Hendricks graduates. We always start every meeting with a question. And everybody is supposed to listen. Question could be as simple as, what is one thing about your faith that you wish everybody in the world would know? Or it could be complicated, like what happened in Paris, how did it make you feel? Or, I mean, I don't know what would be the question. We have asked so many easy and difficult questions, but you have to listen. Same is true in our supper club. We always have a question. Questions that would bring out personal experiences, not on theology, just personal experiences, your personal experiences, that would help you connect with others. So listening and then no judging. So in my youth group, I have a student who was Buddhist, and he remained Buddhist for over a year, and then he became a seeker, and then nowadays he's a Baha'i. And we still sit and listen. We don't pass judgments, we don't say anything, we just listen to his story. And it's extremely important. I think that's why he comes, because he feels safe in that space. So anyways, listening, extremely important for all those who want, anybody who is seriously interested in starting something, and create different ways to listen. Ask questions, give people time to reflect and listen to themselves. Like in our summer camp, at the end of each day, every child was required to journal about that day's experience. They were elementary school kids, but they all did journaling. Some of them did not write, they just drew. But they were supposed to sit down, meditate for 15, we taught them how to meditate. So that was one of the classes every day. But at the end of the day, they were supposed to sit down quietly, meditate for 15 minutes, and then journal. So the concept was they need to listen to themselves and talk to themselves about how was the day. So listening. To me, I think it's, you can't do good interfaith work unless you start listening. Relationship building, we talked a lot about it. I just want to share one more thing. Sometimes it's more rewarding to build a relationship with a person of another faith than the person of your own faith. For me, personally speaking, I feel more solace and comfort and joy in the presence of people who are seekers or who are spiritually, who like to live in a spiritual presence or in divine presence. Doesn't matter what faith they belong to, as compared to people who are of my own faith, but do not care about the divine presence. And I learned that through my interfaith experience. That it's better to be with people who are strongly grounded in their faith than to be with non-religious people. And that's my story. I mean, it's not true for everybody. But relationship building is the key to any interfaith work you want to do. It's hard to do interfaith work without relationship. You can do educational work, which is good, but you can't change people's hearts and minds unless you open your own heart to them. And we've talked about both of them before, unlearning. I talked a little bit about it on Thursday, and somebody had a question. They asked me, how did you unlearn? And I shared my experience about women in Islam, and we talked a little bit about it yesterday. But I think if you want to do interfaith work, just get ready to unlearn all that you have learned. And it's okay, I think. It's absolutely okay. And it comes in different ways and forms, and it's always strengthening. Always. Once I was driving from Russellville back to Little Rock with a friend of mine, who's a Christian pastor, Susan, who I'm really, really, really close to. So I was, so she told me we did an interfaith dialogue class in Russell at Arkansas Tech University, and we were driving back. And she told, and we have our whole schedule always set up for the next 2-3 months, like, because we do workshops together, not work, educational events, which is a Muslim Christian dialogue together. So Susan tells me while we're driving back that, Sophia, I need to change my schedule. I cannot do anything in the mornings anymore. And I'm like, why? We have next 2 months planned every other morning we work together and we do this. She said, I just can't work in the mornings anymore because I heard in my prayer time that I need to spend more time in solitude, meditating. So I'm going to spend 2 hours every morning in meditation. We just need to change our schedule. Now she's driving, I'm sitting there listening. Now there's something some of you know, a few of you know, but most of you don't know that I meditate regularly. I try to meditate regularly. This is a goal that I have for myself. And I have a spiritual teacher, I have a spiritual master or mentor who has been telling me for the last 6 months, not from now, from that day when we were driving a year and a half ago, said, Sophia, you're working too hard. You're always out there in the world. You need to meditate more. And I said, what do you mean by more? At least 2 hours a day. You need to meditate. You need to spend quiet time 2 hours a day. And I'm so busy going out there, doing what I love to do, that I'm not doing that. And I mean, my reserves, my spiritual reserves are getting empty and empty. So this is me at that point. And one thing, I don't know if you know about what Islam means. Islam means peace, but Islam also means submission. And the meaning of a Muslim, the definition of a Muslim is the one who submits. A Muslim is the one who submits. So he or she may live in peace. And that's what I grew up learning, that if you're a Muslim, you have to submit. And it says in our holy book, Samaina wa Atana, you hear, and we hear and we submit. That's who a Muslim is. So anyways, back to the story. You're driving back from Russellville, and Susan tells me, change all the schedules, Sophia. Next 1 month, 2 months, forever, we cannot meet in the morning. 2 months of meditation. Every day I heard in my prayer call today in the morning. And I'm listening and I'm thinking, oh my God, she heard that and she submitted instantly. I've been hearing that for 6 months. I'm not submitting. And I'm telling myself, Sophia, Susan is a way better Muslim than you are. Really, it was a very humbling, but also it's an experience that I can never ever forget. And that day changed my life, because I wasn't doing something which I was supposed to do, which my soul was needing to produce good work. And I'm like, if she can do it, Sophia, I mean, shame on you. You claim to be a Muslim. She's way better than you. And I changed my routine. I said, no, I need to listen to myself. So sometimes when you people, and this happens to me a lot actually, not sometimes, but you need to experience that. Everybody needs to experience that. This kind of, anyway, I think I should stop and let's have some interaction. I have a couple of things in mind. Are there any questions about, so that's a process of unlearning from me. And relearning that I can learn and become more from Christians and become a better Muslim because of my Christian friend. And still love her and respect her and still love my own tradition too. So that was the experience of unlearning. So I want to do a small, another small question video connected to unlearning, unless you have a question right now. Does anybody have a question right now? So if you are going to become an interfaith worker or leader in your community, there are some things you need to keep listening to yourself and keep on checking yourself. That's what I do. And sometimes you lose track, sometimes you come back to track. And these are some of the things that would help you listen to yourself, if you can pass it in the back. And there are many, many more questions. Do we need more? This kind of an activity with a brand new crowd, but within our interfaith circles and friends, we often talk about questions which would help us reflect on our own interfaith journey, and there are many of those. I just picked 4 to give to you so you can track your own interfaith progress, inner progress. And I was wondering if we can just do one. The question number 2, share a moment of unlearning an assumption you held about a religious tradition other than your own. I want you to take a few moments, think about it, if you're comfortable thinking about it. And if you've never had interactions with people of other faith, then I want you to go back to question number 1 and find a moment when you were in an interfaith conflict or doubt. But just take a few moments, think about it, and then let's pair up again and discuss that moment openly and honestly, if you want to. I mean, it's not a must exercise. It's a very powerful exercise if you do it with yourself and with your interfaith friends.
There is a very
much.
That's powerful.
This is Tristan Norman. He's our bell ringer. So we have about 30 more minutes, and I think Sophia's going to show us just a few more things, and we're going to have an open discussion for the rest of it.
So is it a burning comment after this discussion? Otherwise, we'll go to the slides. Okay, so Tristan, let's just go forward step by, go back. So we don't have time, so I'm not going to spend a lot of time on it, but these are some of the things you should be thinking about when you do interfaith work. I forgot about this slide, so not like how to create a safe space, which means place where people can come and feel safe. Not only physically, but also intellectually and emotionally and psychologically and spiritually. And then be very intentional about what kind of invitation you're sending out when you invite people. And how will you greet them? How will the space be laid out? What kind of food will you offer? These are small logistical things. And any interfaith hospitality manual, but specifically the one which was created by Hendrick students, it will help you enormously. But these are important things to think about. You don't want to host an event where Jews come and they're not able to eat anything. And Muslims come, they cannot, and you don't know how to greet a Muslim woman. I mean, we have to be intentional. When we're dealing with people of different cultures and faiths, we need to be intentional. And I remember once we started doing our first prayer services, we removed the cross from the sanctuary so that the Jews and Muslims could be comfortable in that space. And other things, providing prayer space to Muslims if their prayer time is coming during our event. So small things like that. And communications tools, if we can, anybody who's going to work with teenagers or middle schoolers or elementary school kids, it's really important that you have the facilitation and the communication skills, especially when we're talking about faith. Interfaith work is fun and addictive, and it grows on you the way it grows on me, and I just love doing that, but sometimes it can backfire, especially when you're dealing with young kids. So if somebody can help facilitate the dialogue when we're doing dialogue with kids, like in my youth group, we never have unfacilitated dialogue. It's always with facilitators who are trained in conflict resolution and who know how to lead discussion in a certain way. So these are some of the things that you should be, we can't go in detail, it's like each one of them is a whole class time, but just keep them in your mind if you get serious about interfaith work. I gave you these questions for you all to think about, especially the last one. It could be very, very powerful. This has been very powerful for me. I have become really a better Muslim because of my interaction with Christians and Jews. So take it with you and think about them once in a while and track your progress on that as an interfaith person. So we talked about the youth group. Yes. Yeah. Okay, so one of the things that we do a lot, and if somebody wants to do one-time thing, is putting an interfaith service together. Which basically means you invite people from different faiths and you come together under one roof and pray together. And actual prayers, like Jews are doing Jewish prayers and Christians are doing Christian prayers, Muslims and Baha'is and Buddhists are doing their prayers. And we do interfaith prayer service. I organize one big interfaith prayer service on 9/11 every year. We have a great group of people, I'm part of them, led by Second Presbyterian Church, who organize an interfaith prayer service on Thanksgiving every year. Then there's another interfaith prayer service that we started organizing 2 years ago on Martin Luther King Day. So these are one-time events, but quite powerful to be with people of other faith and pray with them and sing hymns with them or listen to them or watching them pray. So something very easy and fun to do is fellowship events like Dr. Bobby Williamson does. I think they're important for relationship building. And if you start becoming more and more intentional about them, like initially you start with just food, and then you bring in dialogue with the food, and you have questions on the table, and people can actually focus on one question and listen to everybody, the fellowship events can actually be very strong interfaith dialogue events. And these are some of the pictures of our fellowship events. Let's go on. Interfaith book group, somebody who's interested in doing a very simple and easy interfaith project, start an interfaith book group. We already have three in Arkansas, Little Rock, Daughters of Abraham, Sisters of Light. I can't remember the name of the third one. Daughters of Abraham is a national group. You can just join the group and start your own little one here, have Christian, Muslim, Jews join. Guidelines are there, book recommendations are there. You just meet up once a month, read a book, discuss the book from a very personal perspective, and then just get to know each other. My Daughters of Abraham group, in which I am, I've been there for 4 years, and these women have become best friends forever because they have shared very personal and intense experiences over the books that they read. So this is something easy to do, but really fulfilling and enriching. This is my Daughters of Abraham group. We meet for Lent and Christmas and Seder and Ramadan meals. So it's not only a book group now, it's a fellowship, and it's like a sisters group. And we meet once a month. We talked about friendship camp. Let's go on. Yes. We talked about choir. Common table is basically a program. It's an interfaith supper club. We have three now. We started with one. It's just like any other supper club. And we just talked about starting one in Conway. My supper club, the first one that we started, we picked one Jewish, one Christian, one Muslim, one Buddhist, and one Hindu family. They did not know each other. We brought them together, set up simple guidelines so the group performs smoothly, like, you know, only vegetarian food, no alcohol, respecting all the traditions. And I have those guidelines. I can send them to you to make it easy. And then we just started meeting. So we five families meet once a month at one of those houses, and we rotate in our houses. And we started as strangers. And every time, it's like a potluck. Everybody makes something, we get together, we always have a question that I pose in the beginning, and everybody talks about it, and they're personal questions, you know, your childhood memory or something about your faith which makes you, makes it very challenging for you to be in this, or it could be anything that I can think of on that day, but that helps people process their personal feelings and emotions and share them and connect at a human level. My common table folks are some of the people which we, as a husband and wife, have shared our most personal memories with as a couple. So this, and now if we don't meet for a month, if I'm very busy and we say we're not meeting, everybody's texting, when are we meeting? Well, we need to meet, it's been such a long time. So this is something really easy to do, any supper club, but it's interfaith. But it's also very, especially nowadays in this post-lecture world, it might be a very simple but fulfilling and rewarding experience if somebody wants to join, and I can help you recruit. It's good to start with folks that you don't know, actually, instead of folks that you know. Let's go on. This is my common table. Let's go on. Okay, so we're gonna, I just wanted to browse through them. We're going to stop and have open-ended discussion because I'm sure you all came with different goals and aspirations in mind, and you heard about a lot of stuff that we do and a lot that we don't do, but I just want this time to be, Dr. McDaniels asked me to do it, for open. Any comments that you have, any suggestions that you have, any ideas that came to your mind while we have been talking about all this work, anything that you think you want to go back and want to take on and work towards, anything, just so.
I'll ask a kind of question to get things started. Sophia, I taught a course in interreligious dialogue with some of the students that are now helping you. And I remember the class vividly, and we sat around a round table.
and they were mostly Christian. But I think maybe we had a Muslim, a Jew, I think. But I remember a moment, I would always ask my students, I would presume you bring your religious perspective to the table, now let's share. And at one point, one of the students said to me, Dr. McDaniel, you don't understand. It's not like we know what our faith is and we bring it to the table. We're figuring out what our faith is at the table. I'm figuring out what it means to be Christian in this dialogue. I'm figuring out what it means to be Muslim in this dialogue. And I hadn't thought of that. But I do wonder if interreligious cooperation provides a context to actually rethink, or think for the first time maybe, what your faith is. And so I'll kind of throw that back to you, but it may be that some of you hear yourself there as well. Has interfaith dialogue, I know it's helped, it's encouraged you to be a better Muslim. Has it affected how you think about your own faith itself, being a Muslim?
Absolutely, Jay. I think it. I am partially, if not mostly, who I am because of my interfaith work in the last 6-7 years. It has stretched my heart and made me accept and do things which I never thought I would ever accept. And then go back to my faith and see, is it still aligned with my faith? You see, on Thursday night, those of you who were there, I shared with you that I work in a church. I am employed by an Episcopal church, so my office is in a church. And I told you that how sometimes when somebody would walk in cafeteria or kitchen and they see me, or in the photocopy room and they see me there, they're a new person, it kind of throws them off their feet. I mean, who's he, what is he doing there? And they'll ask me, can we help you? And I always answer them back. Initially I used to say, no, I'm fine, but now I say, can I help you? So it's been a very, not only enriching or unlearning experience, it's been a really heart-stretching experience for me. And then the second half of my day, those of you who were not there on Thursday, I spent it in a mosque, because I run a mosque. So I have two jobs, and one requires me to be in a church, and the other requires me to be in a mosque, which are two places of worship for two largest groups of faith believers around the world. So yes, I'm changed every day. My life is a process. And if I don't grow, like in our faith, it says that, you know, life means change. If you're not changing, you're dead. So if you were the same person yesterday like you are today, you're a dead person. You need to change. You better be changed towards good. So yes, I am a different person every day because of my interfaith interactions and experiences, and especially because I move in those two worlds, which are generally very segregated. Muslims don't work in church, and then I spend half of my day there and half there. But I want to hear from you all. How have you changed, or because of your interactions with, not necessarily a person of a different faith, a person of a different culture or perspective. For me, this is my life.
I guess for me, it has to take with realizing beauty in a lot of different things, as beauty manifesting in a Buddhist ceremony or in a mosque, or in Christianity, in all these different forms where people come and appreciate and ask questions about what it means to exist and what it means to be alive. And we all have a lot we can contribute to the dialogue, and seeing all these different
responses for what is beautiful in this world is pretty fantastic to see, because I used to not think it was beautiful at all. I was like, what can we find, how can we find beauty in this religion? I don't understand religion, but the more I opened up to the idea of like, talking and understanding that dialogue, the more I can see beauty expressed in a lot of different forms, and that's very formative for me, and that's why I like the idea of interfaith dialogue, at least personally.
I was talking at my table about how a lot of times as like a minority student or as like just like a Muslim girl on campus, I kind of feel like my daily interactions are interfaith interactions simply because like I have to work to kind of adapt to my environment, and I have to work to build those relationships because I'm different. And I think the thing amongst my friends that at least I have been appreciative of is the fact that like that reciprocal kind of activity I think ends up being the most important one, where like it's not only me trying to, you know, cooperate and build relationships with people of other faiths, but also people of other faiths just taking the time to hear and just ask questions to me and just kind of get to know me better, or at least kind of build that side of the interfaith relationship, making sure it isn't, I guess, one-sided is what I'm trying to say. And I did have a follow-up question on that idea. So I just wanted to ask you, like, how often in an interfaith group do you address, like, differences?
How often?
Do you address, like, differences? Because, like, I know a lot of times in interfaith groups, like, we want to talk about, like, our similarities and that we're all the same and that we all, you know, there's things that we all believe in, you know, being good to one another, simple stuff. And I really want to know, like, because it's such a tricky thing
absolutely.
To do, to talk about, like, the differences and, like, hey, you do that, but I can't do that. And just, like, just kind of, like, how often do you address those and how do you address those? It's kind of a little, just a loose day.
Almost all the time. All the time, because one of the goals is, and I think you must have heard it in the videos when I talked about the youth, we all have commonalities. And one of these questions is about commonalities. We all know that we have shared values of service and this. But the reason I do this work is to look at human beings as different, accept them, respect them, and cherish them with all the differences. And that's the goal of the interfaith work, that we need to celebrate differences, if I may say. So yes, I mean, if you're in a place of worship, if you're in a Jewish temple, which we were back in January, just a month ago, exactly a month ago, and you pray, you listen to Jews pray, and then you listen to and pray with actually Christians and with Jews, and then Muslims pray, so you are highlighting those differences. And then you are also accepting them by being in their presence and by praying with them. And then you are giving them that that support that, you know, we not only accept you, we celebrate you because we'll do it with you. We won't just stand here side by side, like Ibu Patel said, in our own worlds, not interacting with each other. So there's a difference between tolerating each other, which is just accepting them, accepting the differences, versus celebrating and cherishing each other. So we need to move forward and do things with each other. And the same is true in youth groups especially. And summer camp, every program, we specifically talk about faith, so we see the differences, and then we accept, and if we don't do that, then I think there is no point in interfaith work. I mean, commonalities just take you so far. You don't build relationships on commonalities, in my opinion. Yes, Bob?
I was just going to follow up on that. So I'm very new in the interfaith conversation, but one of the people who has informed my work is Ibu Patel, Interfaith Youth Corps, and he gets at this issue by, one of the things he says is, when you get together, you don't need to talk about the elephant in the room. And when people say, why don't you talk about the elephant in the room, you say, because there are lots of other interesting animals that we could look at. Right. So let's go to the monkey cage, whatever it is, right? So that somewhere there's, you know, you wouldn't want to have an interfaith gathering where the first question is, how do you feel about the situation in Israel-Palestine, right? Because that's going to tear everyone apart. And so I'm just curious about that balance between what I heard you saying was appreciating differences in constructive ways, but I think there is a point at which if you look at the elephant first, you can make the whole thing fall apart. And I was just wondering what you think about that and if you have experiences.
We have actually tried really, really hard to stay away from political discussions because it does tear people apart. Unfortunately, lately we were not able to do so because religion was dragged into politics and politics is dragged into religion, and it's okay. So I don't know, we're learning. I think we're learning, but I always go back to my three principles, especially two of them, that listen, always listen with an open mind, even if you don't agree, just listen, and then build relationships. Once we do things with each other which are different, which we're not accepting of earlier, and build that relationship, it becomes a little easier to listen to those different, even though we don't agree with them. But that's all we have gotten to. Other than that, you know, I agree with you. We never get into theological or political debates. We don't even pose those questions. Our questions are very personal. What is one of your favorite religious holiday? What do you love most about your faith? What makes you do this or that? I mean, we're connecting at a personal level, but bringing faith in. I don't know. I have no answer to that. I don't even want to go there, but lately we have been forced to after the elections. And my perspective after the election was the same, that let's just find the... That's how I felt, let's just find the spiritual reserves in all the different groups, whether they are liberals or conservatives or this side or that side, and let's just connect at that level. And once we can form those relationships, then we can have those difficult conversations. So let's see. We have 4 years to figure that out. Jay, do you have to say something on that? On this specific topic? I think you'll give us some wisdom.
We have deep cultural divides in our nation today. This is clear to everyone. And sometimes it's within a family. And I myself am interested in interfaith dialogue that seeks to cross those cultural divisions. And so what does it mean to listen to someone who is really at the opposite end of the political spectrum from you? What does it mean to listen to someone who harbors attitudes that you find morally repugnant? And I have no answer except just to agree with you that somehow listening is really important, and that in the act of listening, relationships emerge upon which you can build something. Sometimes we might think we have to have things in common with others before we can have relationships. I think simply listening establishes a relationship after which you can build. You don't have to have things in common.
To kind of follow along with what Dr. McDaniel said, I kind of, this might not be so connected of a point, but I moved here 7 years ago to the United States, and that in itself was a very fortunate kind of a situation because I came from, you know, a very Muslim country to the United States, and that kind of gave me an avenue to talk about my own religion, but also being around, especially like Hendrix students and other friend groups, it was you know, them asking me questions about my religion that actually made me even more curious about my own religion. And I think that's a very important kind of a facility to have. And to talk about conversations, even like when meeting new people, asking people about, you know, not necessarily their religion, but about their spirituality and what they think about it, can lead to, at least in my experiences, some of the most intimate conversations I've ever had. Mm-hmm. And so instead of like, you know, when meeting new people, talking about something like that can really help, just because it lets you talk about, you know, your religion, and then to hear back from someone else about their perspective, and not, even if it's different, not to judge them for that, can lead to, you know, very trusting relationships, especially with people who you're not, you know, necessarily comfortable with, and, you know, that can also give them a reason, you know, if they see that you're receptive to what they're saying, then that'll in itself build trust, and then hopefully close ties that might have existed, or close gaps that might have existed, and create ties.
Absolutely. Listening leads to trust. I mean, you don't have to know each other. You just listen and people trust you. That's true. Let's have one more, and then you raise your hand, and then we'll close.
Yes, I was wondering, kind of in line with what was just said, how much energy, time, and effort you spend having conversations with people that have different viewpoints. Because it seems to me that when you're building the relationships that you have, you reach out to them, and then you build the program from those people who are on board. Mm-hmm. And so what about those people who are not on board? How, and that's what my question is. How much time do you feel is, I don't know, I don't want to say it like that. How much time do you spend on those kinds of relationships?
Most of my time on your relationships, if that's... So now for me, what's happening is that programs and relationships emerge organically. Like friendship camp happened, and out of that, and now I'm not even, I've done those meetings for a year and a half. I don't even go to my friendship camp meetings. My team is so good, they're just working on it. I've moved on to the next two programs, which are coming out of that friendship camp. People who heard about it, people who came, and they wanted to do a meditation workshop or a choir or something. So my personal focus, because that's how I build programs, that I spend a lot more time in reaching out to folks or spending time with them, spending time with folks who reach out to me because they were interested in one of my programs, like Taylor Lomas, who was a student here. She reached out to me, she was interested in interfaith. I spent a lot of time with her, just getting to know her. We started by just sitting, me and her, like this, like me and Tristan. I asked her, what do you like to do? How do you spend your time? Just regular meal conversations. Till we have that kind of a trust and relationship that she wanted to work with me. And she trusted that, you know, that work will be a safe place for her, because she was going to open up her religiosity and spirituality in that space with us. So more time in building new relationships and less in sustaining. Somehow God's sustaining them for me, but we have very little time to do so much. So a lot of I don't know how to now give it a number, maybe 70 to 80% of my time in building new networks and relationships, because once a network is there, then those people do amazing work together. But bringing those people together, even people who were existing in Little Rock for a long time, like different churches, it's not only interfaith, it's intrafaith work, which is also very difficult. Mm-hmm. Bringing those people together to sit on the same table and work with each other, that does take a lot of energy, but once it happens, it just flies. So I can hang around for a little bit afterwards if somebody wants to be on the email list of the Interfaith Center. I want to put a paper here. You can leave your name and email on that sheet, so I can put you on our list, email list, and if there is a new program, you will get an email. Like I have a program coming up at the temple on March 5th, which is a conversation, a facilitated conversation. So you can leave your name and numbers there. I do want to close with that prayer, unless, Jay, you have another idea.
I think it's good to close with a prayer, but let's all, before that, just thank Sophia. Thank you.